portion of this video is brought to you by Surfshark. Heat pumps are versatile, efficient, and great for both heating and cooling. Or are they? Now, whenever heat pumps are mentioned, critics bring up their ineffectiveness in the cold. So is that still true? Or do more modern heat pumps continue to work effectively in cold climates? Now, I'm currently building a new home that's going to have a geothermal heat pump system for heating and air conditioning, and I live in an area that can get pretty cold in the winter. Needless to say, I have a personal interest in this topic. Now, the arguments against the heat pump all the things attitude appears to have some truth, at least on the surface. So should you really be pumped for heat pumps, or is it all a bunch of hot air? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. I've said in previous videos that we should heat pump all the things. Now, thankfully, heat pumps are finally starting to hit the mainstream. Today, worldwide sales of heat pumps are set to soar to record levels as the global energy crisis accelerates their adoption and governments incentivize their use. I remember when I was a kid, my parents downplaying getting a heat pump for our house because they just don't work well in the cold. It's been a common belief for a long time that doesn't seem to want to go away. However, there are promising new models of heat pumps hitting the market with performance that challenges that notion. Now, I'll get into those details in a minute, but for context, let's briefly recap what a heat pump is and how they work. Now, a heat pump is really just a refined series of heat exchangers. When it's hot out, it works similar to an average air conditioner. The indoor coil is filled with a working fluid cooler than the ambient temperature of your house. The hot indoor air passes over the cool fluid-filled coil, allowing our working fluid to steal heat from the air and cool your house down. Now, stealing this heat slightly increases both the temperature and pressure of the fluid. This now warm and slightly pressurized working fluid is then sent through a compressor, which makes it very hot and a pressurized fluid. Next, it's pumped through an outdoor coil where it releases some of its heat back to the outside air, allowing the fluid to cool off and depressurize a little bit. And finally, the warm and slightly pressurized working fluid goes through an expansion valve, which allows the fluid to return to its original cool and depressurized state. It's ready to continue back to the indoor coil and do it all over again. But unlike your fridge or air conditioner, a heat pump has a reversing valve, allowing it to do the, well, reverse, pumping heat into your home from the outside as well. Now, bringing ambient heat inside when it's cold outside might be counterintuitive. Despite the fact that those cold temps reduce a heat pump's efficiency, it's all just physics. And during the entirety of either process, the heart of the system that we're actually spending electrical energy on is the compressor, which doesn't use that much energy. The system is just moving pre-existing heat around and putting physics to work by compressing a fluid to increase its temperature. It's much more efficient than burning fuel for heat. In fact, most heat pumps have a coefficient of performance, or COP, of 2.5, making them 3 to 5 times more efficient than an average 95% efficient gas furnace. Now, COP is the ratio between heat energy that you get out of the system versus the electrical energy that you put in. Now, this has the potential to save you approximately $300 or more annually. Utilizing local bodies of water for heat pumps can produce 6 times more heat energy than the electrical energy that you put into the system. An efficiency close to 600% feels kind of like a physics cheat code. And the benefits don't stop there. Heat pumps require less professional maintenance than combustion systems and have an average lifespan of 15 to 20 years. They're safer than the competition too because they don't burn anything on site and in your home. The potential benefits of heat pumps are even more exciting when we look at the big picture. Heating alone accounted for almost half of all final energy consumption in 2021, making it the single largest energy consumer globally. Efficiency improvements can make a huge difference here. So what's the catch? Well, despite the minimal operational cost for heat pumps, the upfront installation cost can be hefty. Now, according to a study from Poland, which is one of the fastest growing heat pump markets, the total cost of ownership for an air-to-water heat pump was estimated at 8,000 euros, or roughly $8,530, compared to the cost of coal stoves at about 1,500 euros, or about $1,600, or gas boilers at around 3,000 euros, or $3,200. That's quite a lot. Now, the higher cost of heat pumps is mostly tied to the installation process, which in some cases can be complicated or disruptive. I'm specifically talking about ground source or geothermal heat pump systems. It's the most efficient type of system that you can get, but they sometimes require large areas of land to install underground coils horizontally. Now, I'm going through the process of getting a geothermal system installed in my new home, and they drilled a vertical well. While space wasn't an issue by going vertical, there's still geographical studies that have to be done to figure out the placement and get proper permitting. Thankfully, our existing topographical maps for my property that were done a couple of decades ago were enough. Now, that brings us to the potential Achilles heel of heat pumps. they don't work as well in cold weather when you need them the most. Now, when ambient temperature drops to about 5 degrees Celsius or 40 degrees Fahrenheit or lower, it can mess with the working fluid's ability to absorb and release heat by affecting its phase change or thermal properties. Now, basically, it stops just working as well. In response, the overall thermal efficiency of the heat pump decreases and electrical power consumption may increase as the pump has to work harder to achieve heating conditions. And at very low temperatures, frost can accumulate over the exterior coil, which reduces the efficiency even more. Now, this can be overcome if you incorporate a small electric heater into the system, but that comes with additional upfront costs, increased electricity usage, and other complications. But is it still true with newer heat pump tech? Are heat pumps still worth it? Now, before we get into that, I'd like to thank Surfshark for sponsoring this portion of today's video. Now, I always recommend using a VPN when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can be very useful even when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial tracking and machine learning to apply very targeted advertising, and a VPN can protect you from some of that. Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. And one of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all of your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 83% off plus 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. The link's in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and to all of you for supporting the channel. So are heat pumps still worth it? Well, in short, yes. But let's start by busting the big heat pump myth, that heat pumps struggle to pump heat on cold days. There's actually plenty of heat pumps already on the market that tackle colder climates with style. For instance, Northeast Energy Efficiency Partnerships, or NEEP, maintains a database of models that you can buy right now that all perform well in cold weather that's typical for the northeastern United States. But how do heat pumps overcome their greatest weakness? Well, the most exciting improvements use innovative compressor tech. Most compressors can only run at 100%, which can cause undue strain running at max power all the time. Since that style of compressor can't modulate its output for a given thermostat setting, it's wasting electrical energy switching on and off repeatedly. Imagine that you have your thermostat set to, let's say, 72 degrees Fahrenheit. And yes, I live in the United States, so I'm going to use Fahrenheit. Now, the system is going to be switching on and off again and again and again to maintain that temperature. But a variable speed compressor could run at 30% speed to achieve that same exact temp, which increases the efficiency of the entire heat pump system. If you need more heat, then the pump can just move the working fluid through the system faster. Mitsubishi is currently working on an inverter that allows for a process called flash injection. Now, this reroutes hot fluid back to an indoor coil to boost the heating. Now, meanwhile, the cold fluid is routed toward the compressor, which helps to cool it down. This is especially useful during cold weather when the compressor has to work extra hard to maintain high performance heat exchange. The efficiency does dip a little bit in flash injection mode, and it may still have to run the occasional defrost cycle, but even with these additional power draws, cold climate heat pumps or CCHPs like this one still perform more efficiently than an electric resistance heater or fuel-fired system. The efficiency gain may drop, but it doesn't stop. Sounds like a bad 80s pop song. Then there's the smaller engineering tweaks that can be made. CCHPs use fluids that have a lower boiling point than the traditional heat pump counterparts. This allows them to continue flowing through the system at low ambient temperatures and draw more heat energy from cold air, even when it's freezing outside. Some CCHPs also use reduced ambient airflow rates, increased compressor capacity, or other improvements to configure the compression cycle. However, there are some negatives to some of these CCHP fluids because they can have a negative impact on the environment if they're released. Now, similar to electric motors or other tech I've previously covered, there's all sorts of little optimization tweaks that you can make to tailor a device to your needs. So it should be no surprise that there's a lot of companies working to optimize heat pumps right now. Here in the US, that's partially due to the Department of Energy's Residential Cold Climate Heat Pump Challenge. Launched in 2021, this program encourages companies to develop, test, and commercialize heat pumps to perform beyond current best-in-class products in 5 to negative 15 degrees Fahrenheit weather, which is about negative 15 to negative 26. These companies have kept their innovative techniques close to their chests, but the progress has been verified by the Oak Ridge National Laboratory, and they seem to be on track for the challenge's end goal of 2024. For example, Texas-based Lennox was reportedly the first company to develop a prototype to meet the CCHP challenge, and they did it about a year ahead of schedule. They're even going to make the jump to commercialization next year. Then there's Train in North Carolina, who announced that their prototype had passed Department of Energy scrutiny last November. Train's prototype is especially durable, performing in temperatures as low as negative 23 degrees Fahrenheit. That's about negative 30.5 degrees Celsius. It exceeds the Department of Energy temperature requirement. The Florida-based company Carrier also celebrated its prototype passing the test in November of last year. And they claim their CCHP is designed to communicate with the grid so it can be told to moderate its energy use during peak hours. It uses environmentally conscious working fluids to boot. Like Lennox, they're expecting commercialization next year. And finally, Johnson Controls in Wisconsin has built an air source heat pump prototype for locations with temperatures below negative 20 degrees Fahrenheit, or about negative 29 degrees Celsius. Designed with AHRI standard 1380 certifications in mind, this is another CCHP that can smartly curtail its energy consumption during peak hours. It's worth noting that in addition to their challenge entry, Johnson Controls already has two heat pumps on the market that meet these previously mentioned NEEP standards. So the cold really isn't a problem anymore outside the most extreme circumstances. This leads us to the second biggest hurdle, that pricey initial investment. Even if a heat pump pays for itself over time, not everyone can afford the startup costs. Luckily, help is on the way. There are rebates here in the US for heat pump installation packaged as part of the Inflation Reduction Act, or the IRA. Also, according to the White House, households can claim a tax credit for 30% of the cost of buying and installing a heat pump, up to $2,000. This also includes any electrical system upgrades needed to make the home heat pump ready. These incentives aren't limited to the federal level, as 15 states and 100 cities are offering low and moderate income households with point of sale rebates up to $8,000. And if your home needs upgrades in order to integrate a new heat pump, you might qualify for an additional $4,000 rebate on those. And it's not just the United States. France, Germany, and almost 30 other countries already have heat pump rebates in place. As the war in Ukraine continues to increase gas prices around the world, more countries are considering similar forms of financial aid. These rebates may not always cover the entire cost, but they make heat pumps viable for those who may not be able to afford one otherwise. As a final added benefit, it's estimated that by 2030, a surge in heat pump demand could require over 1.3 million workers to install all those heat pumps, nearly triple the current amount. That's potentially a lot of skilled green jobs that could add to the global economy. Heat pumps are getting more popular every day, and it's easy to see why. The issues that used to hold them back are dropping like the winter temperature, and more innovators and homeowners are investing in heat pump technology. If you've hesitated to get a heat pump in the past because you live in a cold climate, now's the time to give heat pumps another look. There's plenty of modern models on the market right now that can handle the coldest winters that the Midwest or New England can throw at them. As heat pump technology continues to improve at a rapid rate, complications like the disruptive installation process and sustainability concerns are actively being addressed. And with increasingly widespread government discounts from multiple sources, that high initial investment should be much easier to handle, so you and your family can just get around to enjoying the savings from these super efficient heat pumps. It's not often that we get an emerging piece of tech that actually makes serious strides towards decarbonization, saving you a significant amount of money over time, and has very few drawbacks, and already on the market. No matter what your motivation is to get one, whether that's decarbonization or just saving money on energy costs, heat pumps aren't just hot air. And there's another technology that you could say the exact same thing about, and that's solar. Is it the right fit for you or not? It can be tricky to figure out along with what to get for solar in the first place, and that's exactly why I created the Achieve Energy Security with Solar Guide. It can be overwhelming because you don't know what you don't know. I've been there, and I want you to feel confident about what you actually need for your home and personal goals. After going through this guide, you'll be able to figure out how much solar energy that you need, what kind of equipment might make sense for your house, and how to vet a qualified installer. This will even help you decide if solar is actually the right move for you or not. Now, I just released this guide at a discounted price for a limited time. So go to the URL in the description for more details and to become a founding member. As part of this initial offer, I'm going to be holding a group Zoom call to answer questions that you may have after going through the guide. I'm really excited to help as many of you as I can to go through this process and to evolve the guide over time. Once you buy the guide, you'll get access to updates that I make to it for free. And check the link in the description if you want to learn more. So do you want one of these newer heat pumps for your home? Any experience with them? Jump into the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still To Be Determined, where I'll be discussing some of your feedback. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones over here. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video for your continued support. You're helping to reduce my dependence on YouTube to pay for producing these videos. And thanks to all of you for watching and commenting. I'll see you in the next one.